highest quality legal representation. At Liberty Law Group, we will fight for you. Call 877-42-LIBERTY. Once again, that's 877-42-LIBERTY.
Go Hog Wild Pit Barbecue.
If the week's been too hectic to even think about dinner, or your family can't handle one more night of leftovers, then it's time to let Hog Wild do the cooking. Hog Wild's family packs are one heck of a good deal for a complete barbecue meal loaded with all the smoked meats, tasty sides, buns, and sauces you need to feed your family. Order online at GoHogWild.com. Hog Wild Pit Barbecue, 3210 Cornhusker Highway in Lincoln.
But don't be late, we close at 8.
Get rid of pesky critters once and for all with Bats to Rats. Their expert team is here to help you reclaim your home. No more sleepless nights caused by crawling critters or flapping wings. Bats to Rats ensures a safe environment for every family member. Check the website at BatsToRats.com for amazing offers. And if you mention this ad, you'll receive $10 off your initial inspection cost. Call Bats to Rats today at 402-781-8691. That's 402-781-8691. Bats to Rats.
Here you go. Coffee's on me and my new BFF. I thought I was your best friend forever. BFF, like best financial friend, at Members Own Credit Union. Right now, they're offering $100 when you consolidate or transfer a loan or an existing credit card balance and meet requirements. Plus, you get great rates and free advice from a financial partner that will put you first.
That sounds like a match made in heaven.
Members Own Credit Union is the type of bestie you can count on. Get started today at membersowncu.org/BFF. Limitations may apply. Equal housing opportunity.
For over 15 years, Integrated Life Choices has empowered individuals with disabilities in Lincoln and throughout Nebraska. They provide comprehensive services from group homes and independent living services to job training, ensuring fulfilling lives for those that they serve. Now, they're inviting you to join their mission. If you're passionate about making a difference in the lives of people with developmental disabilities, explore rewarding career opportunities with them. Learn more about their services and apply today at www.ilc.net. Be a part of Integrated Life Choices, where your work truly changes lives.
Your home is your empire. Protect it with Empire Fence. Get a free instant quote with the online estimating tool at empire-fence.com. See an upfront estimate with no hidden fees. An Empire Fence can provide privacy and improve the appearance of your home. Keep kids and pets in or out of your yard. Increase security and add value to your property. Visit empire-fence.com now to view the stylish and maintenance-free possibilities for your home and get a free instant online quote. Let Empire Fence protect your empire.
This is Adam Carriker on the ticket.
Position right of the quarterback, out of the shotgun, first and 20. Jailbreak screen in the air. It is tipped. It is intercepted by Carriker at the Missouri 21-yard line.
Live from the heart of Lincoln, America, eight-year NFL vet and All-American defensive lineman Adam Carriker.
Shotgun snap to Everett. He's got the left arm going, and now he's got a whole lot of Adam Carriker who rips him down inside the 25-yard line.
On 93.7 The Ticket and theticketfm.com. Here's your host, Adam Carriker.
Welcome, everybody, into Adam Carriker on The Ticket. As always, hope you're having a glorious Friday. Hope you have a wonderful case of the Fridays. If you've never seen the movie Office Space, go check it out. They don't have a case of the Fridays there. They got a case of the Mondays. Nobody wants a case of the Mondays. So I'm wishing you all a glorious case of the Fridays. Now, as always, it's a loaded show. I mean, it really is. It's crazy. This should just be called The Loaded Show. Just take my name out of the show. Just call it The Loaded Show. Because it is. It's always loaded. All right, here's some of the topics at hand. Nebraska's quarterbacks, they speak. I'll be honest, they didn't say a whole lot, but they did speak. The quarterback's coach speaks as well. The offensive coordinator speaks. He talks about what they want to emphasize the most and improve on offense going forward into the future. If I'm going to be honest with you, he's not wrong in the area that we need to improve. Let's not forget the run game first. He didn't say that. I'm just saying, let's not do it, whether we say it or not. Okay. Then we're going to talk Keisei Tominaga. He basically set the three-point competition on fire last night. Entertaining, as always. Dynamic. Little showboating, which I love in a three-point competition. All right. Fred Hoiberg, Coach of the Year. Well-deserved. By the way, National Coach of the Year. But when it comes to the Big Ten, co-Big Ten Coach of the Year? Something doesn't add up there. But congratulations to Coach Hoiberg on winning the National Coach of the Year Award. All right. A couple of Nebraska men's basketball players have said they're coming back to Lincoln. Chat about that real quick. Chat about just some brief expectations for next year's team. Let's be honest. There's going to be more comings, more goings, more things that change. So it's going to be brief. But the biggest things I think they need to improve on in order to make next season just as good, maybe better than this past basketball season. Okay. Then let's chat about, and I wasn't going to say anything on this, not because it's some big decision I decided to make, some moral quandrum. I just hadn't gotten around to it, but now I've gotten around to it. Does Nick Saban have a bit of a double standard? Does the man who's made millions and millions of dollars off the backs of college football players and by being an all-time great coach, does he have a bit of a double standard on his approach or his what he said anyways, his thoughts on NIL and basically why he said he left coaching? A man who's been around for a long time, had a lot of success. He's earned the right to do what he wants. But does he have a bit of a double standard on his approach to NIL and collegiate athletes getting paid? We're going to get to that. Corey Ross is going to be joining me. Pork Chop, one of my favorite all-time teammates. All right. Former Nebraska offensive MVP, all Big 12 performer. All right. Corey Ross, former Nebraska running back, is going to be joining me at 12:30, ladies and gentlemen. And then we're going to finish talking about Caitlin Clark. Okay. And it's interesting to me because I call him Coach Gino, the UConn women's basketball coach. If you didn't know, Caitlin Clark wanted to go to UConn. He not only didn't offer her, he never spoke to her once throughout the recruiting process. So I did a deep dive into that. Not too deep of a dive, more like a medium dive. It was deeper than not deep, but not like a deep dive. So kind of like a medium dive. And I found some interesting things. Okay. So we're going to chat about all that. Now, real quick, as always, the last eight minutes of this show, the people segment. Now, I've had so much to talk about recently. I haven't always been able to get to everything in the people segment, but do me a favor today. I want to reemphasize the people segment. Call or send me your questions to 402-464-5685. Call or text 402-464-5685. You can leave them in the comments section of YouTube as well. Let's light this candle. All right. The quarterbacks, they spoke. Heinrich Harburg, Dylan Raiola, Daniel Kalen. All right. Our offensive coordinators, the co-offensive coordinators, they both spoke. Now, I'll be honest with you, not a ton was said. You know, nothing revolutionary or shocking. Not a whole lot to talk about when it came to the quarterbacks, which I consider to be great. That works for me. I got no problem with that. Now, it was interesting. There was a little bit of debate online about whether freshmen, quarterbacks in particular, should speak to the media. Now, Matt Rhule's obviously let him speak, so you know his stance. I've always kind of preferred shielding freshmen who are adjusting to college, who are adjusting to being away from home. Some of them are halfway across the country. That was my experience. All new people, all new surroundings, all new everything, trying to catch up to the speed of the game, et cetera, et cetera. You know, maybe shield them from the media for a year. Okay. And if I recall, I don't believe Arch Manning spoke until going into the bowl game last year at Texas. And then there was that infamous picture of Quinn Ewers sitting there by himself while all the media was talking to Arch Manning, which was a little bit misleading. You know, I'm gonna shock you with this. You can't believe everything you see online and or read, because it came out a little bit later after that the media had already spoken to Quinn Ewers and they had just then moved on to Arch Manning. But the picture led you to believe that nobody wanted to talk to Texas's starting quarterback at the time. Wow, what a guffaw right there. I do apologize. But that was not, in fact, the case. So some people like that approach. Some people let freshmen speak. I've always kind of erred towards the approach of, you know, maybe shield them, protect them for a little bit. Maybe there's better ways to word that, but you get my point. Let them adjust to college life before they deal with microphones in front of their face. Now, I thought about that. And if we do that at the quarterback position, we've only got one quarterback who can even talk because two of our three quarterbacks are true freshmen. So I wonder if that factored into the equation when Matt Rhule decided to let them speak. He obviously trusts Dylan, okay, and Daniel, all right, Raiola and Kalen to be able to speak eloquently. That would not have been the case with me as a freshman. I don't believe I spoke as a freshman, okay? Maybe Corey Ross can verify that or deny it. I don't know. But so it was interesting. Not a lot came from the quarterbacks when they spoke. That was, you know, newsworthy headline type stuff, which again, I like that. I would actually argue maybe the OCs had more to say. Marcus Satterfield in particular talked about how they're kind of emphasizing the pass game. They want to improve the pass game. If you watch our offense last year, yeah, the pass game was not very good. Okay, the receivers couldn't get separation. Jalen Lloyd was really our only kind of sort of deep threat. Malachi Coleman had the one deep bomb for a touchdown. I think it was 44-yard touchdown reception, I believe, versus Northwestern. That, you know, there wasn't a whole lot of ability to stretch the defense vertically and spread them out and make them defend the whole field, whether it be consistent, accurate, deep passes from the quarterbacks, which we were not getting, and the receivers were not open. And the pass blocking from the O-line was not as good as the run blocking. So it all kind of goes hand in hand. I don't think it falls on any one person, any one individual. Now, when Marcus Satterfield said that, I agreed. But there were certain times last year when I felt like we came out and tried to throw the ball and emphasize throwing the ball. And I was like, why aren't we running the ball more? Now, we obviously ran the ball very well. We ran the ball enough. I just don't want to overemphasize one thing and forget about the other. And I don't think they're going to do that. But let's be a run-the-ball-first team and just continue to gradually improve the pass game. And if we do it more than gradually at a faster rate than that, that'd be okay too. I'm just saying, let's remain a run-first team, because I got the feeling at times last year like Marcus Satterfield wants to throw the ball a lot. We just didn't have the ability to do it consistently last year. And that's fine if we can, but let's remain a physical, blue-collar, in-your-face, smash-mouth type of football team first. And Dylan Raiola, Daniel Kalen, okay, so the Swiss knife, Heinrich Harburg, they got abilities. Obviously, Daniel and Dylan are known a little bit more for throwing the ball. If they can read the defenses, because these Big Ten D coordinators, they're going to come at them. They're going to throw exotic blitzes at them. They're going to try to confuse them. They're going to do everything they can. That is what they do for a living. And now you've got these young men who are doing this for a first time. So as long as they can make quick reads, audibles, things of that nature, I'm all for throwing the ball as much as possible, as long as we run the ball first. So those are kind of my quick thoughts on the quarterbacks, the offensive coordinators, and them speaking a little bit earlier this week. Now, if you missed it, I did put out my way too early record prediction show right on the Carriker Chronicles early this week. You can check it out on YouTube, CarrikerChronicles.com, which was interesting because I actually felt like I was late doing it. So this is obviously way too early to do a record prediction show, which is why you just kind of do it for fun, tongue in cheek, so to speak. Although I did an insane amount of research. But I felt like I was a month late because it was, what, 4 to 6 weeks ago that the over-under win-loss total for Nebraska came out at 7.5. And here I am doing it like a month, month and a half later. So I actually felt late doing my way too early win-loss record prediction show. But if you got nothing better to do with your life, or you just enjoyed talking Nebraska football, or maybe hearing yours truly flap my gums from time to time, you can check that out on YouTube and or CarrikerChronicles.com. All right, Keisei Tominaga. I know I'm biased. I try not to be. Everyone knows that. I don't know how successful I am at being unbiased, but I try. I try my best. One of the most entertaining, fun basketball players in college basketball history, just from an entertainment, can shoot the ball, his reactions, him being just as shocked as the ball went in as anybody else, those type of reactions, his showmanship. You know, he's one of the most fun basketball players, college basketball players I've ever had the pleasure of watching. All right, so Keisei won the three-point contest at the U.S. College three-point contest on ESPN last night. Now, the semifinals, he won 24-23 over Ohio State. Okay, Jameson Tyler, okay. And for a while, I thought he wasn't going to miss a shot. Like, he was just zoom, zoom, zoom. I mean, he had an extra 5-6 seconds every time. A lot of time you watch these, the NBA All-Star three-point competition, okay, usually around, like, Valentine's. And they're usually like, they're rushing to get those final shots in. They can't get, like, Keisei, he had an extra 5-6 seconds at every rack as he was going around the 3-point arc. And at one point in time, I was like, is he going to miss? Obviously, he did. He is human. You know, it is allowed. But at the last ball, I don't think they call it the money ball, whatever they call it. I forget. It's the first time I've ever watched the college basketball 3-point competition. I'm used to the money ball from the NBA three-point competition, but whatever that two-point ball is at the end, he had like an extra 4 seconds, right? And he just stood there, and he just waited. I think he even threw a dribble in, and I was like, oh, my God, he's going to wait too long. And if you watch the clock, like, it leaves his hand right before it hits zero, turns around, don't even think he watched it going in. Steph Curry-esque. Steph Curry-like. Swish. Talk about epic three-point shooting skill, showmanship, and just entertainment factor. All right, so K-State wins the three-point competition. Now, I'm never going to forget his hands on the head. Just shocked look celebrations. They're so fun. So this is a guy that plays with great passion, great energy. And here's why I feel it's truly entertaining. There are, you know, some folks who put on a show on purpose, and that's okay. I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I find that entertaining in a different way too. And sometimes just as entertaining, sometimes more, sometimes less. To me, Casey's entertaining because he's so passionate. He's energetic. And it's clearly not pre-planned. Either that or he's a phenomenal actor and he needs to go start doing some starring roles out in Hollywood. I don't think that's the case. I think it's just genuine, like, oh my gosh, I can't believe what's going on. I love playing this game. And that's how it comes across to me. And I believe it was either Rico or Jake. I can't remember. I want to say it was Rico that talked about a couple of weeks ago with me that he was a galvanizing figure for Nebraska basketball. And when we really needed it, honestly. He was a guy that was good at what he does, okay? And there was times he was pulled out of games by Coach Hoiberg, you know, but that's just a coach, by the way, National Coach of the Year, demanding the best from his players. But he was a galvanizing figure because he's good at what he does. He's entertaining, okay? And he helped actually bring Nebraska fans together beyond just the wins and losses on the court as well. Now, I can't help but wonder about his NBA potential. I'm not going to sit here and pretend that I'm some sort of NBA draft scout expert in any way, shape, or form. But I'm obviously going to be rooting for him. He can obviously shoot. No question about any of that. You know, if I were an NBA draft scout, which would be laughable, but let's just have fun for a minute. My biggest question marks would be, can he improve defensively? Okay. And play just a little bit more explosively, right? Those would be the two biggest things. But I tell you what, he's going to be fun to watch no matter what he does, no matter where he goes, and I'm going to be rooting for him 100%. And I want to thank him for his time here at the University of Nebraska. All right, next up, Coach Fred Hoiberg, co-Big Ten Coach of the Year, but the National Coach of the Year, solo, I might add. So congratulations to Coach Hoiberg. One fan, you know, I don't know. Sometimes it does feel like the Big Ten has it out for Nebraska. And then sometimes I'm like, ah, let's get over it. And then you win National Coach of the Year, but co-Big Ten Coach of the Year, I'm going to let it go. All right, so it was pretty cool how he found out. If you saw the video, it's like a two-minute video they put out. Okay, and basically his wife and his kids are the ones who told him that he won it. So I thought that was pretty cool, that it was his wife, it was his kids, it was a genuine surprise. He did not know it was coming. Probably realistically wasn't even on his radar, okay, that he had won the Coach of the Year. All right, so Coach Hoiberg, as I mentioned, was a recipient of the 2024 Jim Phelan National Coach of the Year on Thursday afternoon. All right, this award is presented annually to the nation's top Division I coach. The recipient of the annual award is determined by a 10-member voting committee, which consists of current and former head coaches, as well as two senior staff members of collegeinsider.com. Hoiberg guided the Huskers to one of the most successful seasons in program history in 2023-2024, as Nebraska went 23-11 to reach the NCAA tournament for the first time since 2014. The 23 wins were the most Nebraska. Okay, let me read that again. The 23 wins were the most since Nebraska won a school record 26 games 1990-1991. While going 12-8 in the Big Ten, the Huskers' third-place finish in the Big Ten Conference was the best since joining the conference in the 2011-2012. The program's best conference finish since 92-93, the good old Big Eight days. Pretty cool because Nebraska posted two wins over top 10 teams this last year, including the program's first win over a number one team since 1982. That's 2 years before I was born, by the way, ladies and gentlemen. Reached the Big Ten tournament semifinals for the first time in program history for his efforts. I already mentioned this. He shared the Big Ten Coach of the Year, okay, with Purdue's Matt Painter. Hey, if Matt Painter and Purdue go on to win a national title, more power to him. I'm rooting for him because they're from the Big Ten. All right. Hoiberg is the second Husker men's basketball coach to earn the honor, as Tim Miles won it in 2014. Hoiberg was chosen from a group of 20 finalists from across the country. It marks the second straight season that a Big Ten coach has won the award, joining 2023 recipient Chris Collins of Northwestern. All right. The Jim Phelan Award is named in honor of the legendary Bowtie coach who spent his entire coaching career at Mount St. Mary's University. He led the Mountaineers to 16 Division II NCAA tournaments. Five times they advanced to the Final Four, and he led them to the Division II National Championship in 1962. When he retired in 2003, after coaching for 49 years, he had amassed 830 wins, an overall record of 830 and 524 in all divisions in those 49 years. Man, that's a lot of coaching. 19 of his teams amassed 20 or more wins in a season. So again, congratulations to Coach Hoiberg. Well deserved. And I harken back to something he said towards the end of the season. He indicated, obviously we're happy to have him, but he indicated that he likes to hear a lot, so much so that he could see himself finishing his career here in Lincoln at the good old University of Nebraska. Now, more good news for men's basketball yesterday. We've had some departures and things of that nature. That's just how college sports works nowadays, right? You ain't got to like it. You ain't got to love it, but it is what it is. All right. Nebraska men's basketball players Jawan Gary and Bryce Williams announced they are coming back to play for Husker basketball next season. Now, it's interesting because there's a lot of comings and goings that's still going to happen. We all know that. All right. So it got me kind of thinking about expectations for next year. And before I want to talk about expectations at all too much, I want to address some of the things that I think that could help the team, because as awesome of a season as they had, still searching for that first NCAA tournament win. All right. So for me, improving physicality down low, finding a big man down low, just overall physicality down low, but finding a centerpiece, a big man down low. And we've got some guys there right now. I'm not saying we don't. I'm just saying stepping it up a notch, improving it a notch. Okay. In that last game of the year, A&M was more physical. They just were. A&M's the top offensive rebounding team in the country, so I don't think it was a surprise that they were going to be physical. I think how aggressively they went to the hoop on offense. They clearly didn't feel threatened by our interior defense. I was surprised how often they just went straight to the hoop. We need more physicality when it comes to rebounding, but when it comes to a shot-blocking presence. Okay, so I am 6'6". All right. So a lot of people ask me, why didn't you play basketball? And I've said this before other places. I didn't play basketball because 6'6 is not tall in basketball. Okay. And my playing weight at Nebraska was 295. So basically I would have been a fat guard. But here's my point. In high school, okay, I knew my role. I was cool with my role. Football and baseball were the games I was the best at. Okay. Basketball, actually growing up, was the sport I won the most championships in. I was on an AAU basketball team with three future first round draft picks on it down the road. None of them in basketball, oddly enough, but I digress. My role, I was Dennis Rodman. My role was, and I was not, in high school, I was kind of tall-esque, but I was by no means like really tall. There were plenty of guys I played against that were taller than me. But my role was rebounding, physicality, defense, and if you needed somebody hacked, I'd hack the crap out of you. That was my role. I'd get, you know, 8-10 points a game. I was cool with that. But if anybody came in the paint and I was on defense, I took it as an insult if they didn't have a hesitation in their step. If they didn't have it, they were going to get it. Now, there, if you're listening, you're probably putting together I fouled out of a few games. But I wasn't in foul trouble all the time. Just, you know, occasionally. But my point is getting more physical down low. And up top, as good as the Huskers did last year, a lot of things they did really well in men's basketball team, a little bit more explosiveness in our play, whether it be offensively or defensively. That explosive first step is something I think that would help us. And that would help us, I mean, finishing third in the Big Ten, beating two top 10 teams, a number one team, court stormings, a lot of things that went really, really well. If we can get more physical down low, a little bit more explosive up top, I think that that would really, really help men's basketball. And Keisei Tominaga is not going to be an easy guy to replace, but I'm excited to see what the National Coach of the Year and our returning Huskers and the new Nebraska basketball players can do next season. All right, ladies and gentlemen, don't go anywhere. I will be joined by my former Nebraska teammate, Corey Ross, Mr. Porkchop. We'll be right back.
Several irrigation contractors in Lincoln go out of business every year, leaving sprinkler system orphans begging for service. The folks at Judson Irrigation shed a tear for these little fellas. They've been coddling these orphans for more than 40 years. From redesign, repairing, replacing, and restoring, remember the Judson Irrigation Orphanage.
Call the Judson Irrigation Orphanage 402-420-6277 or judsonirrigation.com.
Sandhills Global is hiring. With their fast-paced, growing culture, they have hundreds of new openings in sales, marketing, traveling support, software development, web design, and more. Full-time roles offer a 4.5-day work week, along with flexible internships in most areas. Career and internship opportunities are available at our global headquarters in Lincoln, Nebraska. Find your fit today at www.sandhills.jobs.
At Union Bank, people don't have your money. Your money has people. First Home people, investment people, people people, people who answer the phone and your chats, dream car people, dream retirement people, driving your dream car in your dream retirement people, small business people, credit card people, and all the other people you need. At Union Bank, our people help you do more than you dreamed possible. So stop in and say hello. We can't wait to see you. Union Bank and Trust, member FDIC.
The playoff race is heating up, and the Lincoln Stars are pushing for their third consecutive postseason berth this spring. Join us at the Icebox as the Stars host the Sioux City Musketeers at 7.05 p.m. on Friday and the Omaha Lancers at 6.05 on Saturday. Friday is FFA and Ag Night, and Saturday is Billet Appreciation Night. Lock in your seats for all the fights, checks, and goals now at LincolnStars.com.
Problem gambling is not just a financial issue. It's an emotional problem with financial consequences. If you or a loved one is struggling with addiction, contact Choices Treatment Center's 24-hour helpline at 402-476-2300. That's 402-476-2300.
The Mill Coffee and Tea, formerly with only 4 Lincoln locations. Guess what?
What?
There's 5 Lincoln locations now. Oh my gosh. That's 25% more Lincoln locations than there used to be. Can you even imagine a world where there's only 4 Lincoln Mill locations? Feels like ages ago. We were all so young then. The Mill on 11th, located right alongside 93.7 The Ticket Studios, 1040 O Street.
For over 15 years, Integrated Life Choices has empowered individuals with disabilities in Lincoln and throughout Nebraska. They provide comprehensive services from group homes and independent living services to job training, ensuring fulfilling lives for those that they serve. Now, they're inviting you to join their mission. If you're passionate about making a difference in the lives of people with developmental disabilities, explore rewarding career opportunities with them. Learn more about their services and apply today at www.ilc.net. Be a part of Integrated Life Choices, where your work truly changes lives.
Alcohol has strained our relationship. Drinking too much can cause harm to friends, family members, and loved ones. By drinking less, we will save our relationship. If you or a loved one is looking for help, find a treatment facility near you at findtreatment.gov. For immediate support, call, text, or chat 988.
Brought to you by Nebraska DHHS in partnership with SAMHSA.
Load up on meat and more this spring at the Mercado by Certified Piedmontese at 84th and Havre. This week's special through April 9th is buy one, get one free on 8-ounce flat iron steaks, limit 4 per visit. Also, $1.50 off all Bachan's Japanese barbecue sauces. And don't forget about lunch on Fired Up Friday from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Locations at 84th and Havelock and 30th and Yankee Hill in Lincoln or 168th and Maple in Omaha. Get to the Mercado today for the best meat in town.
Old School with DP and J.
So I knew that it was a crapshoot with the grown-up professional at the highest level. Who's going to bet? I don't know whether the starting center's girlfriend broke up with him, whether his parents have groceries that week. I don't know whether his roommate and him had a fight. So why would I want to bet on that?
93.7 The Ticket and theticketfm.com.
Rashawn Jackson here for Bauer Infrastructure, a veteran-owned local company proudly serving Lincoln, Lancaster County, and the surrounding areas. Bauer provides quality work at an affordable price, and they're growing rapidly. If you want to experience a career with a fast-paced, family-friendly environment, visit BauerInfrastructure.com. They have top-of-the-line benefits, year-round work, even through the winter. Bauer, usher in the new era of infrastructure to an area near you. And as always, go Big Red!
You're listening to Adam Carriker on The Ticket on 93.7 The Ticket and theticketfm.com.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Adam Carriker on The Ticket. each and every Friday. Just a reminder, I am live from noon to 1 p.m. Central Time. Tuesdays and Thursdays, the Carriker Chronicles and the Big Ten Show. Wednesdays, former All-American Nebraska quarterback Steve Taylor drops that knowledge. Basically, noon to 1 p.m. Central Time, each and every day right here on The Ticket is the fastest hour in radio every single weekday. All right, join us, grab your lunch, hopefully have some fun along the way. And as always, sending your questions, comments, thoughts, concerns, and or otherwise to 402-464-5685. I will answer all those the last 8 minutes of the show. Now, I am joined by a Nebraska legend, one of my favorite teammates of all time. This man was a Nebraska team captain, Huskers offensive MVP, 2004, 2005, two-time All-Big 12 performer, twice on the Doak Walker Award watch list, Nebraska record holder for receptions, 9 in receiving yards, 131 in a game by a running back, Mr. Corey Ross. How you doing, my friend?
My man, how you doing, man? I appreciate the intro. That was beautiful to
hear. Yeah, absolutely, dude. So you mentioned to me in your a text beforehand, just so people have a heads up, the voice is a little sore today, but I appreciate you powering through. You probably had to get a Toradol shot to join me, but I appreciate it, man. So no, I interviewed you about a year ago. And there may be a couple of crossover questions just for the folks who did not hear some of those questions and answers. And this is one of those, but it's worth asking again. The nickname Pork Chop. How'd you get that, my friend?
Oh, man. There's so many stories to how that has happened, but I'll have to give that credit to Beyonte Grigsby. The running backs had a thing where we all kind of had nicknames. And when we came in and, you know, the older age to us and Dante made some pork chops for the introduction from at his house. You know, I went over there and I didn't know Dante Grizzly could cook like that. So I ate about 3 or so pork chops. And he told Coach Gillespie at the time that I ate 7 pork chops. And right there, Darren Dicker jumps out and laughing real loud and goes, "Chop." And obviously, I'm short, thick, like a pork chop, so everybody's thinking that's what it is, and it just stood. That's kind of how it came about.
Man, from 3 or 4 to 7. Why don't let facts get in the way of a good story, right? All right. It's funny.
Tell me about it.
I actually coached a kid starting in 4th grade, and I coached him for 5 years in football. His name was Brody. We had 2 Brodies on our football team, so I was trying to figure out a way to differentiate the two. And so Brody, who was the offensive lineman, the other one was the running back, had a crush. It just said crush t-shirt on it. And so I started calling him Crush. And here he is going into high school next year. And everybody calls him Crush just because he wore a t-shirt one time, one day. By the way, what a great nickname for a football player.
That is.
All right, man. So we're going to go backwards before we go forwards, as I tend to do in my interviews. Talk to me, because, you know, Bill Callahan is perceived different ways, various ways by Nebraska fans and Husker Nation. What was your experience like playing for Coach Callahan? What are your thoughts on your career under Coach Callahan here at Nebraska?
Quite honestly, if it wasn't for Bill Callahan and Randy Jordan coming in and introducing that offense to us, and myself included, and just let me go into that offense and really just become who I became. I don't know if my career would have been where it was, because it was just everything that you wanted and everything you wanted to learn from a playbook standpoint when it comes to getting to the next level. I enjoyed every bit of having Coach Callahan there as my coach, being able to get to know him more, his family, being that we were captains that senior year. And going in there and enjoying having those conversations, but just realizing, you know, what his approach was and what he really wanted to do. He might have been misunderstood by a lot of people that really didn't get him or understand him, but I got to see a different side. And, you know, I got to be around Coach Jordan, a lot of those coaches at the time, rest in peace, Coach Blake, a lot of those guys really was one of the main reasons why I think I became the type of player I became, and it helped me to make a roster, an NFL roster, by knowing as fast as I was able to. I have nothing but love and respect for what he did for me and not only our team and what he was trying to for the city and the state of Nebraska with his style of playing that fun offense. Creative.
Yeah, it's funny. I think Coach Randy Jordan, the former running backs coach when you were there, I think he's still out in D.C. I could be wrong, but he'd been out there for many, many years. In fact,
he's now with the Tennessee Titans now.
He is. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Yeah. So as I was going out the door in D.C., Coach Jordan was just coming in the door. And actually, Coach Callahan was the offensive line coach for a couple of years there as well. So that was the last time I saw them. So it's been a while. But in 2002, I mean, it was a loaded running backs room. David Horn, et cetera. All right, you were sixth on the running back depth chart, you know, at one point throughout that offseason. How'd you climb to the top of what was a stacked running back room at during that time?
You know, I would like to say just grit, man. You know, I think at the time, you know, when we were in school, there wasn't a transfer portal, so you had to – you know, go through everything that you had to go through. Should I went through injuries. I had a shoulder injury my freshman year, and they had shoulder surgery, so I didn't even get to play as a freshman. I thought I would because I thought I was going to be ready to play, and I ended up having shoulder surgery, so I had to sit out a year there. Then I was starting, and I had a really good camp going into spring training, and then going into fall camp, I ended up spraining my MCL, and I had to understand that, hey, these injuries are the reasons why I'm not getting an opportunity. I think when I get an opportunity, I will be able to show what I can do. And I just had to be patient with it. I mean, there were times where I probably didn't know if this was going to be the school for me. But I knew all the things that I was going through wasn't nothing that was inflicted by the coaches. It was just, hey, these things happen in football. So let's see if I can get healthy. Let's give myself an opportunity to just give it a shot. And when I got a shot against KU, you know, I went in and had a heck of a game. And ever since that game, even Coach Solis at the time came in the room and was like, hey, we're going to give you another opportunity to start, because I did some things in that game that, you know, we weren't able to do that year, you know. And so it was awesome. And ever since then, went from KU, K-State, Colorado, and then obviously those guys got let go of, and I had to prove myself again with Coach Callahan and those new coaches. But it was, for me, just sitting there, grit, man, just wanting to be a part of it, wanting to win, wanting to stay in Nebraska and be a part of everything, and really just trying to, you know, hey, earn my scholarship and really show, you know, these coaches what I can do and show the city what I can do.
So you talk about Coach Solich real briefly during that answer. So it comes into my mind, I got to ask you this. What are your thoughts on Coach Solich, our former coach, coming back to Nebraska and being honored recently, but also going into the College Football Hall of Fame?
Yeah, I really wish I was there. I remember I had a game at the time. I got the group text from Josh Davis and a lot of those guys. Coach Solich was a father figure. He stepped in my room in my house when he came to get us on a recruiting trip. He stepped in my house and had probably one of the coolest, most calming conversations I've ever seen my dad and my mom a part of. And I knew that man was going to be somebody I want to coach for. So I think like everybody else, And I think like everyone else, it hurt so much when he got let go, especially with the changes he was making and trying to change the direction of where we were going to go. That was very unfortunate. But as we all know how this world works, you got to still move when whatever happens. And so I had to adjust to Callahan and whatnot. But what Frank Solich was able to do for me and really stood on what he said, you know, he's going to give me an opportunity. And I have to earn my keep. And I had to make sure, you know, when I got the opportunity, I had to seize it. He said that to the group. He said it to all nine of us. And I think all nine of us all knew, you know, if you would forget, we had Marcus Simmons and a couple others that was in that room at the time. That, hey, when you get an opportunity, you got to take advantage of it, and you got to be ready for it, you know. And that one thing that I learned from Coach Solis was just that. And when I did get the opportunity, I didn't know if the next week they were going to play me. I just thought, hey, it was a lucky game. I had a great game. The next week he walked in there and said, you're going to start this week. And I was sitting fourth on the depth chart before they put me in the second half against KU, you know. So he stood on his word, man, and he said that when he came to my recruiting visit and sat down in my mom and dad's house and he stood on it. I love him for it, and I truly appreciate him. I always watch what he's doing in Ohio, man, and he still went on there to be another great coach and did really great for them. So, man, I love what we did, what the city did for him and brought back, and he deserves everything he's getting because he's a great coach.
So it's a loaded running back room again this year, man. And in different ways throughout your career, you can probably relate to a lot of these guys. You look at Gabe Irvin, Ramir Johnson coming back from injuries similar to you. You think of Emmett Johnson, who ended up fourth to starting last year. Now he's got to prove himself all over again with Gabe coming back and Ramir playing, and you got the transfer from Oregon, Dante Dowdell. And so he's got to prove himself again, much like you had to do when Callahan and his crew came in. And then you've got Quentin Ives, a guy who's fighting for – he's actually getting a lot of reps right now due to some of the guys not being clear just yet, but kind of like you, maybe a little bit deeper on the depth chart right now, but he's trying to work his way up. You can relate to just about all the guys in this room. So what advice would you give these guys, knowing college football is a little bit different today, though?
I would say – the advice I would give them right now, man, is just to seize every opportunity you get and just cherish those moments. But realize how serious it is, man. If I'd have known how much and how important working out was, like we know we run, we go train, we go through all conditioning stuff, and a lot of us hate it, right? We don't really take it serious. And it wasn't until I really got to the next level of the NFL where I realized how much of a business this is, but you also have to take and treat your body that way because that is the reason you are playing. And if I would have known that when I was a freshman, I probably would have played faster because I was just a young kid out there having fun, enjoying, you know, meeting new people from all walks of life and living life with them and enjoying the group, but not really understanding, hey, I need to get my body together so it can become healthy. And like I said, Dave Kennedy, shout out to him when he came in as part of that staff with the Bill Callahan crew. Man, he turned me into a machine, and I felt really good and was able to stay healthy enough to make sure I was able to do the things that I do. Not only, you know, so I would tell those guys, take it a little bit more serious. I know it's fun. College can be fun, but that is the most important part. If you can keep yourself healthy. And when the opportunity presents itself, you got to be ready for it. You got to know the playbook. You got to know how to protect. All those things are key. Like, you can be a great runner, but if you don't know how to protect, we got to take you off the field on third downs or big downs. And now we don't know what we want to really do with you. And now you have to be able to catch the ball, run the ball, block. Those things are huge in this game, especially as a running back. And now, especially nowadays with running backs. But I tell those guys, focus on their bodies, stay healthy, do everything you need to be to stay on that football field. And when you're on that football field, know what you're doing and handle your business.
All right, I want to give a shout out to Nicholas Snyder, who sent in a comment. He says, Adam, Corey's my all-time favorite football player growing up, and I was even called pork chop in midget football. If I was taller than 5'4", you would be next in line. He sends like a laughing emoji. You both are inspirational. So I want to give a shout out to Nicholas. And as always, you guys can send in your comments on YouTube and or call or text 402-464-5685. Yeah, for sure. This is the Aloe Fiber VIP line. All right, man. So last year, Nebraska ran the ball really well, effectively throughout the entire season, top five, top 10 in the country for most of the year when it came to rushing the ball, which is incredibly impressive because they did struggle to pass the ball, and they're trying to improve that this offseason. But as you watched Nebraska last year on offense, what were your thoughts as, man, they're doing this really well, and what are some things you think they could improve on going into next year?
I think we all, you know, we all know what it was, really. We just couldn't pass the football. And when you're not able to do that or not win those one-on-one battles on the outside, when you get the opportunity to or not be able to deliver the passes on time or with great accuracy, it's going to struggle, period. So now they can put those guys in the box and really try to stop the run, and we were still able to run pretty well. That's what's crazy. So that, for me, what I want to see is just a transition now to what we can do in the passing game, create more play action, utilizing the tight end a whole lot more. Maybe even bring a fullback back into the system and have some fun with that. I think we did a little bit last season, but I think they need to utilize that more and really get a passing attack. Maybe start with the simple things, the small short throws to free up some things, but we have to get a passing attack because I really believe the offense is going to be headed in the right direction. We got some running backs there that I think are going to be able to take full up our opportunity, and a lot of those guys have gotten reps and now they're ready to continue playing. So I'm excited to see where this goes. I mean, like, I think everybody's excited about Mr. Raiola over there coming back. And obviously, you know, his brother was there when I was a freshman, or his dad was there when I was a freshman. So it's crazy to even be talking about it. But it's going to be awesome to see what they decide to do and where we go from here, not even just this year, but the next 3 or 4 years. Because I think Coach Wills is doing a great job, and how he is as a man and everything that he says just speak volume. Just when you're able to watch and listen, even when he's in the media and talk talking to everyone else. He just stands on what you want to be. He almost reminds me of how Coach Soltz kind of stands on his word and how he stands on talking to kids and really want to develop them, not only in just football, but in life. And when you have that kind of approach to a college system, it can turn around and be great. So when we keep him involved and he stays here longer than, you know, 5 or 6 years, let's see what happens with the Huskers, man. I think the sky's the limit with the approach that they're taking. So I'm excited about it.
All right, Corey, I appreciate you taking the time to join me. And don't go anywhere, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be right back.
Your home is your empire. Protect it with Empire Fence. Get a free instant quote with the online estimating tool at empire-fence.com. See an upfront estimate with no hidden fees. An Empire Fence can provide privacy and improve the appearance of your home. Keep kids and pets in or out of your yard. Increase security and add value to your property. Visit empire-fence.com now to view the stylish and maintenance-free possibilities for your home and get a free instant online quote. Let Empire Fence protect your empire.
You don't think about your roof very often, but you should never take it for granted. Roofing Service Company takes every measure to provide you with the highest quality roofing solution. Whether it's a new roof installation, roof repair, or a re-roofing project, their overall goal is to provide you with a pleasant experience and a long-lasting roof. If you have a need for siding or gutters, they're your place too. Visit roofingservicecompany.com for more info today.
Here you go. Coffee's on me and my new BFF. I thought I was your best friend forever. BFF, like best financial friend at Members Own Credit Union. Right now, they're offering $100 when you consolidate or transfer a loan or an existing credit card balance and meet requirements. Plus, you get great rates and free advice from a financial partner that will put you first. That sounds like a match made in heaven. Members Own Credit Union is the type of bestie you can count on. Get started today at membersowncu.org/BFF. Limitations may apply. Equal housing opportunity.
Several irrigation contractors in Lincoln go out of business every year, leaving sprinkler system orphans begging for service. The folks at Judson Irrigation shed a tear for these little fellas. They've been coddling these orphans for more than 40 years. From redesign, repairing, replacing, and restoring, remember the Judson Irrigation Orphanage.
Call the Judson Irrigation Orphanage, 402-420-6277 or judsonirrigation.com.
Are you looking to get into the electrical construction industry or wanting a new scene? The Electrical Workers of Local Union 265 are now hiring licensed journeymen and apprentices and are offering great pay and benefits. Call Mike at 402-875-1034 to apply. Start your electrical career today.
Load up on meat and more this spring at the Mercado by Certified Piedmontese at 84th and Havre. This week's special through April 9th is buy one, get one free on 8-ounce flat iron steaks, limit 4 per visit. Also, $1.50 off all Bachan's Japanese barbecue sauces. And don't forget about lunch on Fired Up Friday from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Locations at 84th and Havelock and 30th and Yankee Hill in Lincoln or 168th and Maple in Omaha. Get to the Mercado today for the best meat in town.
Okay, it's time to sell the house. How do we even begin to choose from the hundreds of realtors in town?
Easy, we make a pros list.
You mean a pros and cons list?
No, just a pros list. We need someone with pro photography to showcase the house in the best possible way, pro marketing to make sure we get maximum exposure, pro negotiations so we know we get the best price.
This is one of those times where you already know the right answer, isn't it?
You know it is. Ben Bleicher and Professional Realty Group.
Contact Ben Bleicher and the team at Professional Realty Group of Berkshire Hathaway's Home Services Ambassador. Online at prg-ne.com.
In every office, there's two types of people. There are those who bring in bagels and those who eat the bagels that someone else brought in. Everybody likes the first person. Be that first person. Weekday mornings at 7:30, you have a chance to win a business box of bagels from Bagels and Joe. All you have to do is shut up Sipple. Two questions for you, two for Sip. Win and the bagels are yours. Lose, well, you don't want to lose.
You lost Monday, you lost Wednesday, you're a loser.
Shut up Sipple. Weekday mornings at 7:30, brought to you by Bagels and Joe.
Hi folks, Sean Callahan here for Koppel Chevrolet GMC, and the Chevrolet and GMC truck month is now underway. We've got huge savings in Lewisville. Get $9,000 off our 1.9% for 72 months on select models. Yes, you heard right. That's 9,000 off our 1.9% for 72 months happening right now at Koppel. So take that short money saving drive down 144th Street or check us out online at koppelcars.com. You'll be glad you did. All deals with approved credit. Stock number G214773.
93.7 The Ticket. Fox KFXL Weather. Sponsored by John Henry's Plumbing, Heating, and Air Conditioning.
Your Lincoln forecast for today, we'll see mainly sunny skies and more mild weather. Afternoon high around 66. Tonight, probably cloudy and breezy. A low around 42. And tomorrow, we'll see increasing clouds, a chance of showers and thunderstorms in the afternoon. It'll be windy with a high around 71. I'm meteorologist Kyle Klecker for 93.7 The Ticket and theticketfm.com.
Spring is here. It's time to get back outside and into proper shoes this year. Brown Shoe Fit is the place to buy this spring with their sale on athletic shoes. Get $15 off any regular price athletic shoes with respected brands like Hoka, Brooks, New Balance, and On Running. And don't forget, Brown's carries a large arrangement of sizes and widths to fit your feet properly. Start your spring off right at Brown Shoe Fit, just south of 66 and Q in Lincoln.
You're listening to Adam Carriker on The Ticket on 93.7 The Ticket and theticketfm.com.
Boom. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Adam Carriker on The Ticket. Now, I actually had somebody text me a question. Let me see. All right. I know we're friends. I'll keep their name out of this, but let's use better English. It's hard to read the question. I think basically what they're asking is what my thoughts on Bill Callahan was, having played for him. You know, it was interesting because Callahan, you got to keep in mind, he was fresh off the Raiders. There was a lot of hurt feelings on his side. In fact, my former defensive line coach, rest in peace, John Blake, he was a former head coach at University of Oklahoma. He told me that Callahan used to come into his office, you know, usually about once a week when he first got there, and then it kind of went away over time. And he would, I don't want to say breakdown, but he had a really hard time. Okay. And he knew Coach Blake kind of had that head coaching experience. So he kind of tried to, you know, learn a little bit from Coach Blake, I guess, or whatever you want to take it, kind of feed off each other. There were things that, you know, I wasn't crazy about the fact that he didn't respect Nebraska traditions. There were certain traditions he just didn't respect. When you look at, he recruited well. When you look at the offense actually did pretty well. There were certain things that he actually did pretty well. I would have liked to have thought, had we did a little better on defense, and I'm on that defense, so I can say it. You know, I mean, we led the nation in sacks with, 50 sacks in my junior year. So there were certain things that we did well. You know, maybe that could have helped out just a little bit. And me being one of the leaders on that defense, you know, I kind of shoulder that too. So it's one of those things where I think you look back on his era now, you compare it to a Mike Riley era, you compare it to all much love to Scott Frost who wants to get back into coaching, you compare it to a Scott Frost era. And I think people view it a little bit differently than they did immediately after that era was over. So I think Bill Callahan, there's certain things maybe I wish would have gone differently. Not maybe, I wish would have gone differently. I think there's certain things he did actually do fairly well. I did recruit well. You know, I think people viewed it completely differently right after it was over than they do now. At least some folks, not everybody. Everybody's entitled to their opinion. So we do have questions that are rolling in here. So let's get to them. Notorious B.I.B. Hey, glad to have you back. It's been a while. Adam, after losing to Creighton, wouldn't a win against Ohio State in baseball feel pretty good tonight? Yes. We win 10 in a row, and we were bound to lose, but did it have to be against Creighton? Oh, I just want nice things. Nebraska baseball is ranked, 110 in a row, having a great season, much like so many of other Husker sports. Proud of them, but did it have to beat a Creighton? Were there mock go big red chants afterwards? Not cool. Yes, beating Ohio State would be pretty good. Although, let's be honest, it's kind of Nebraska and Michigan in the Big Ten for the most part. And I know Ohio State's pretty decent, but in baseball anyways. So, yes, beating Ohio State would sure be nice. Jerry and Casey, where do you see the biggest improvement taking place with the Huskers offense? Quarterback position or wide receiver? Both. Both those. Those are the two I would go to. Man, the offensive line's going to be better. They ran. They did run block. They ran block. Proper English here, Adam, or just some sort of English that's coherent. They ran block pretty well last year, as we know. They didn't pass block the best, but, you know, we struggled to be accurate. We struggled to have wide receivers get open, which creates a need for the O-line to pass block longer, and then the guys aren't open, and the quarterbacks are struggling. So it all goes together, as I mentioned earlier in the show. I think the quarterback play is probably going to be better. If Harburg starts, I know everyone's anticipating Dylan. I get that. I'm still saying open competition. If Harburg starts, he's got to be better than he was a year ago, after, especially after he got banged up. If he gets beat out by a freshman, then you got to assume that they were better than who we had starting a year ago, because you got to assume Harburg is better. And if they beat him out, then they've, you know, obviously they look better in practice. Dylan Raiola has certain skills that maybe no quarterback ever at the University of Nebraska has had when it comes to arm strength, talent, things of that nature. Man, looking forward to that equating on the field. Hopefully that is the case much sooner rather than later. He's still a very young man. So I would say quarterback and wide receiver. It's funny you went to those two positions. You talk about Jamal Banks, Isaiah Nair, Malachi Coleman's going to be a year older. He was a true freshman. You got Jalen Lloyd, who was a speedster, made some big plays for us. He was a true freshman. Now they're all a year older. Now you're bringing these other guys who've started at other universities and been all-conference type players in other conferences. Isaiah Nair with the Mountain West, then he went to Texas. You got Jamal Banks in the ACC, probably the most accomplished transfer that we brought in, along with Micah Mazuka, the bazooka, at offensive guard. So I would think quarterback, my biggest hope is quarterback and wide receiver. All right. So I got a couple other things. If there's any other questions, feel free to throw them up there, Rico. I got a couple other things to get to real quick. You know, I'm going to save the Saban thing. That's kind of an evergreen thing, and I'm late on it anyway, so I'm going to save that for next week. But let's get to Coach Gino, the UConn women's basketball coach, probably the greatest women's basketball coach of all time, not only not recruiting, not offering a scholarship, but not even talking to probably the greatest women's basketball player of all time. So greatest women's basketball coach of all time, not even talking to the greatest women's basketball player, at least in college, of all time during recruiting. Now, I read this the other day, but I'm going to read this again. All right. Via Twitter, X, whatever it is, Joe Pompliano, at 12.3 million viewers last night. This was a few days ago. I saved the screenshot. Last night's Iowa-LSU game had more viewers than any women's college basketball game ever. The 2023 NBA Finals, the 2023 World Series, the 2023 Orange Bowl, the 2023 Big Ten Championship. Everybody knew Iowa wasn't going to score in that game, so why watch? The 2023 Cotton Bowl. Does anybody watch bowl games anymore? The 2023 Pac-12 Championship. I'm just going to say last year. Last year's Big 12 Championship. Last year's ACC Championship. Last year's Peach Bowl. Thursday night football games. And every 2023 college football regular season game, barring Ohio State, Michigan. That's pretty impressive. Okay? A lot of that's Kim Mulkey, Angel Reese, a lot of that's Caitlin Clark. Now, this is per Ben Stevens on X. Got it right that time. Caitlin Clark is the only D1 player to post 40 points, 10 assists in an NCAA tournament game ever. She's done it twice. All right. Paige Buckers is the only D1 player to average 25 points, 8 rebounds, 4 assists, 2 steals, 2 blocks in a 7-game span in the last 25 years. This is building up to the Iowa-UConn women's matchup in the Final Four. UConn is on a 7-0 run. Okay, 7-0 in this run, their last 7 games. A historical Final Four that is coming up. This is a UConn team that's beat up, too. They got like 7 or 6 players out. There's only 7 players they can actually rely on, and a lot of them are freshmen and sophomores. All right, so let's get to Coach Gino and Caitlin. All right, I'm just going to read a lot of this, and I'll offer some thoughts at the end, and we'll wrap up the show. And again, I'm going to save Nick Saban for Monday. UConn was Caitlin Clark's dream school, and yet Coach Gino Auriemma never reached out to her during her recruiting process. With UConn and Iowa set to square off this Friday in the Final Four, Coach Gino explained his side of the story. For starters, Coach Gino was already committed to Paige Beckers, who was the number one recruit in the entire nation in the 2020 class, so there's good reason there. Okay, Coach said he didn't want to crowd his backcourt and take opportunities away from the girl he was recruiting and he was committed to. She was committed to him, Paige Beckers. He also claims Clark never told him that she wanted to play for the Huskies. Well, there's a lot of kids we didn't recruit, and there's a lot of kids who don't want to come to UConn, he said. Okay, I committed to Paige Buckers very, very early, and it would have been silly for me to say, Paige, hey, listen, we're going to put you in the backcourt, and then I'm going to try really hard to recruit Caitlin Clark, who's also going to be in the backcourt and a point guard. I don't do it that way. Caitlin is obviously a tremendous player, generational talent, but if Caitlin really wanted to come to UConn, she would have called me and said, Coach, I really want to come to UConn. Neither of us lost out. She made the best decision for her, and it worked out great for us. We made the decision we thought we needed to make. End that quote. Now, I will say this. That's not how recruiting works. Coaches reach out to players. Now, don't worry. Coach Gino comes off very well in this next thing I'm about to read. But that is not how recruiting works. I mean, there are players who send tapes. I think we still use the phrase tapes, but you know what I mean. Tapes out to colleges. Okay. But the overarching, and players will go to camps hoping to get noticed, but it is the coach who comes up and says, we're interested in you when it comes to actually talking. Okay. I don't see a whole lot of players going to coaches' front doors and knocking on their doors and calling their cell phones. Okay. It's the other way around. All right. Now, Oriam didn't want to crowd his backcourt and take opportunities away from Paige, who he's already committed to. He also claims Clark never told him that she wanted to play for the Huskies. Just talked about that. I actually just read all that. All right. I'm going to throw that paper away. So here's the next article. All right. Then I'm going to read real quick. UConn head coach, I call him Coach Gino. Okay. The man who did not offer Clark a chance to play for the Huskies coming out of high school 4 years ago had nothing but praise for her Monday after his team advanced to face Iowa in the Final Four. So I loved everything Coach Gino had to say other than she didn't tell me she wanted to play for us. The rest of this is phenomenal. Coach Gino spoke at length about Clark's greatness after UConn beat USC 80-73 in the Elite Eight round. Okay. He noted her 41-point performance in the 94-87 victory over LSU on Monday, and he implied he hoped his team would not face her wrath if she indeed was motivated by a vendetta against the Tigers. He said, and I quote, I hope Caitlin Clark had a personal agenda against LSU, end quote. Coach Gino joked. He said, and I quote, I know there's nothing personal between me or her, so I don't need to be seeing her drop 50 on us this upcoming weekend, you know? End quote, the coach said with a smirk. So I love her, he said. I think she's the best player. Forget I ever said UConn guard. This was interesting to me, too. He's talking about his own player. He said, forget I ever said UConn guard Cage Beckers is the best player in the country. Talking about his own player. Now, maybe he gave her a heads up he was going to say this. Maybe he's trying to motivate her, his own player, talking about. As reporters began to laugh out loud, Coach Gino concluded of Clark, and I underline this, I think she's the best player of all time. I don't know. Whoever said that I said that Paige, his own player, is the best player in the country, he concluded. Now, I thought that was interesting because why do you need to say she's the best player in the country? Okay, because your own players are going to hear what you have to say. And then he specifically compared, and there's a reason for Paige and Caitlin to be compared, but he specifically said, it's not my own player, it's the player she's going to play against. I thought that was interesting. Now, this dude has won so many titles, won so many basketball games, know so much more about that sport. I mean, he could forget everything he's ever known and probably still know more than me. Yeah, that doesn't make sense, but you understand what I'm saying. My point is simply this. My point is I find it interesting because I feel that he would say that. I feel like he's trying to calm the beast of not pissing off Caitlin Clark, yet motivate his own player, who's obviously very, very good and talented in her own right. And that just made that matchup between UConn and Iowa even that much more intriguing for me. I got to be honest with you. We got the men's. I don't know what I'm going to do this weekend. We got the men's Final Four. We got the women's Final Four. We got WrestleMania Night 1 with Roman Reigns and The Rock against Cody Rhodes and Seth Rollins, that walking clown emoji. And then Night 2, it's Roman Reigns versus Cody Rhodes. Is he going to finish the story? Is he not? I don't really care. I just want to see how many times The Rock interferes in the match and who else comes down because it's going to be bloodline rules. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, how shame on you for not watching and following what The Rock's been doing in WWE lately. I know it's predetermined, but so is the movie you're going to watch this weekend. All right, ladies and gentlemen, have a great weekend. Until next time, go Big Red and always remember to throw the bug.
Is Lincoln's home for sports talk on the FM dial. Also online at theticketfm.com.
On the internet.
KNTK FM Firth, 93.7 The Ticket.
Spring is here and it's time to wake up Judson. Judson Irrigation is eager and ready to get your sprinkler system up and running for the season. Judson's technicians will check for winter damage, adjust your sprinkler heads, and show you how to set your controller for effective sprinkling coverage. The Judson Irrigation team is here for you. Stay safe.
Keep summer green. Call Judson Irrigation 402-420-6277 or judsonirrigation.com.
Your home is your empire. Protect it with Empire Fence.
Get a free instant quote with the online estimating tool at empire-fence.com. See an upfront estimate with no hidden fees. An Empire Fence can provide privacy and improve the appearance of your home. Keep kids and pets in or out of your yard. Increase security and add value to your property. Visit empire-fence.com now to view the stylish and maintenance-free possibilities for your home and get a free instant online quote. Let Empire Fence protect your empire.
Empower a child today with the Teammates Mentoring Program. Hope is only a conversation away when you